assalamu alaikum. Welcome to another show. This is the Munir Muhammad Show. My name is Ismail Muhammad. I am a faithful and loyal member of this organization, CROE, an organization I very much do love and appreciate. And I'll just be your guest host for this episode here. And today we have the co-founders of the organization, Brother Shahid Muslim and Brother Halif Muhammad, joining me here today to have a timely discussion, especially about what's happening in the upcoming days and what's going to be in the media and talked about. And we want to get out ahead of that and make sure we put the truth out. We want to make sure people understand and know the real facts about what is going to be talked about as far as the Nation of Islam, these conversations about the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and these conversations about the Malcolm X. So joining me today is are the co-founders. Thank you, brothers, for allowing me to be here and to host this and to sit down and speak with you, brothers. Assalamu alaikum to you.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, sir. I want to jump right into it because this can be a lengthy conversation. There's so much to say about it. So we did a show previous setting the foundation about the order of the Nation of Islam, the structure, the power, how everything is disseminated. We have established that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad had absolute power. Nothing happened in the Nation of Islam without his approval. And if something happened in the Nation of Islam without his approval, that particular person was dealt with.
Yeah.
So, I'll put it like that, because I want people to understand and know that this was a monarch. He was an absolute sovereign ruler over the Nation of Islam, and that was it. And that's how we see him. That's how I see him. That's how I know of him today. I was not there. You two brothers were there. This is what I learned of him from his own words, from his teachings. And this is what you two brothers also confirm in your experiences in history, and you telling and sharing it with the other members here at CROE. I had the opportunity to come here with a blank slate, as I would say. I didn't know much of anything about Malcolm X. We did read the autobiography in high school for African history study class. But even with that, I didn't actually read the book. I just showed up to class. I wasn't very attentive in class at all, as far as academia is concerned. But I do remember it was required for me to purchase the book. I sat there and, I didn't really pay attention to anything. So I didn't really know much of anything about it. And I was even questioned if I had any input that I wanted to share about it. And at that time, I did not, unfortunately. But later, I think it was maybe a year later, I ended up being introduced to this organization. And this is where I really got to first know who the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was, who he was, and the importance of him. And then also all the history that comes along around it. Mm-hmm. So everything I know about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad came from the archives. It wasn't Brother Munir or Brother Halif or Brother Shahid giving me something. You all three of you brothers pointed me to this tape, this book, this page, this article, this newspaper.
Yes, sir.
Produced by the Nation of Islam, not any outside. We had supporting evidence from outside publications and resources, mm-hmm. and people who vouched for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I would say. But everything I know about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad came from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And so the same is with Muhammad Ali. And so the same is Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. Everything I know about Malcolm X came from Malcolm X. I didn't learn it from a documentary, some type of biography, a film, a historian, a so-called, Hotep Pan-Africanist, whatever you want to call them. Civil rights, none of that. I learned it from Malcolm. I learned about him from himself in that way of from the archives here. And that's the importance of this organization, CROE, which is a coalition for the remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. coalition meeting. Anybody can come here and learn about this history, learn about the history of themselves, learn about the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and get the true facts. And I just happened to be another number that came through the door. And as many have come through the door.
Teach.
And I happened to pick this up. I wasn't one that just came and picked the book up and never returned. I really actually studied the history. And I pride myself, I guess I'm a archivist now, as I'm a member of the archives.
Right.
So with that being said, I thank you two brothers, and I thank Brother Munir Muhammad, though he is not here with us present today. His work is still here with us, and his presence in that is still here with us. So I thank you three brothers for one, having the wherewithal, the audacity to start an organization like this, the will with or the love in your heart for the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad to start an organization like this and have it for over 30 years, well over 30 years. We're getting closer to 40. And we've had so many people come through here and be enlightened about the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And that's what this show is all about, is to enlighten people, to teach them and to give them the true facts. Not because we want people to believe in Honorable Elijah Muhammad or anything like that, even though that would be good for them if they did do that. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wasn't for Muslims. He wasn't for Sunnis or Wahhabis and Shiites or even just the Nation of Islam. He was for the black man in the nation of North America, right? He was sent to black men, women, and children in North America.
That's right.
That's who he was sent to. He wasn't sent to Muslims. He wasn't sent to just Christians or Jews or anything like that. He was sent to us all. And that's what his aim was, to get this message that he was presented with or ordered and directed to give to us. And that's how we see him. We see him as a messenger. He had a divine message for us that can help us, that has helped us, and he proved it, in every aspect of our being in this country. And it also has spread outside of this country, throughout North America, Central America, Europe, and Africa. But the main core was here in the States. So with that being said, we are coming upon the birth anniversary of Malcolm X. And there's going to be a lot of trash being shared around.
Right.
And I describe it as trash. I could say lies or misthink, but just some of the stuff that you hear is just so bizarre and just off the wall and just, it's just so fictional. And what we want to do here today is, we don't waste any more time. We want to get into this and we want to understand first, what criteria are we judging Malcolm when we say or label him as a hypocrite? We want to talk about that today. We also want to talk about some myths about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad maybe having jealousy or envy of Malcolm. And we want to talk about his journey into al-Islam or Orthodox Islam. He said he's an Orthodox Muslim. That's what he said. That's not what I heard from somebody.
Right.
That's not what I read from somebody else, somebody in a dashiki. Malcolm said that himself. He's Orthodox Muslim. So he said that on national television. So I didn't have a private conversation with him. Mm-hmm. So if that is known fact, Malcolm was a Muslim, right? And he was a follower of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And to be a follower of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you have to voluntarily submit that you want to follow Islam, that you want to pick up this religion, it is your true religion, and that you believe that God has appeared for us, has come to redeem us and resurrect us, and that he sent a messenger, and that messenger is the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Anybody who joins the Nation of Islam had to make that declaration. It wasn't forced upon them. It is something that is totally voluntary. And that's what Malcolm did. He made his declaration, he put it in writing, he received his X. He worked his in the Nation of Islam for over a decade. And he rose to the position where he became a minister, and then he rose to the position where he became a national representative. Now, we can quickly describe or define what a national representative role is and what authority and power that they have. If any one of your brothers want to.
Let me first respond by saying how pleased I am to hear your description of what you found here, you know, because this wasn't by osmosis, you know, this was a design, you know, and we stressed upon ourselves that great pains are taken to use only the last messenger's word. But I couldn't help but feel a little bit of pride in knowing that you learned so much from coming here that, you know, that shows me the importance of so many other people that we founded this for, you know, that they would recognize and appreciate the greatness of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And when you speak of Malcolm, you know, just like anybody else, you know, we not only changed our thought, we changed our name. We did all of these things in order to become a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But to in the fourth surah, I think, 148th verse, they say something about Allah loves not the public utterance of hurtful speech. And, you know, unless you've been wrong in the public, then you can respond in the public. And I say that in premise to saying anything about Malcolm X, because the term hypocrite does apply as far as I understand and as far as I'm concerned. Because anytime a man lifts you up out of the mud, as he did, when any of us, and all of us will attest that he did raise us to a level that we surprised ourselves, that we would strive to be righteous in all of our deeds. And I don't just pledge that for today. I'm striving for that always, and that's what I expect of any follower. But anytime a man has been given all of this and they turn their back on the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the man who gives it to you, made us all great individuals, you know, it's got to be a great person to want to start a school like this, a coalition, if you will, where you point and define and defend the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man who's been on the job for more than 44 years and reached people that I didn't think, I know I was one that wasn't looking for him, but I found him. And I'm sure that Malcolm did as well. He did a fine job for 12 and a half years as representing the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But he didn't affect me as far as bringing me. I'm affected by the aftermath of him. You know, my learning was like yours about, I never met Malcolm, nor did I meet a lot of people who got an X somewhere behind their name. I am grateful that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad caused me to want to tell the truth, even if the truth testifies against us. And that's what we're doing with Malcolm X, because he's been shot out there by people who didn't know what he did, none of his experiences, but just through hearsay, and hearsay from people that didn't have a clue about him themselves. And it should be blaspheme to be celebrating someone like that, you know. And I know that's harsh. people find that unforgiving, but that's because they don't know. And our job is to try to make them know.
Yes, sir. Brother Shahid, when it comes down to Islam, and it comes down to the Nation of Islam and our beliefs, Malcolm was one who once stood at the podium and said publicly that he believes in the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Right.
And that he believes in Islam and that he's a messenger. Now, at what point do you think that, was it when the messenger set him down that he no longer believed that? Was it at some point before? Was it Wallace Muhammad, the son of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, feeding into his ear? At what point do you think that Malcolm X stopped having that belief?
Well, I can't pinpoint it like maybe some people might want me to, but it might be when Wallace started telling them things, or it might be when he got sit down, because, you know, see, like I said before, once you way up here, brother, and then you get knocked down to here, your body don't function the same. That's just it. You don't function the same because you used to being on top. You used to giving orders, but now you got to take orders from some of the people who you used to give orders to. That's a different thing on you, and some people just can't handle that. But that's just the way it is. Some people can, some people can't. I have seen people, lieutenants and captains, get busted. Some of them can handle it, some of them they can't handle it. And that's the way it goes. But see, the messenger say, that book, Message to the Black Man in America, that's who the messenger came here to teach. Now, if you was a good brother and a brother that wanted to be a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he taught you and put you in a certain position, that's what you were supposed to do. Do what he told you to do, because he's your messenger. He's giving you the orders, because like he tells you, don't try to be with God. You listen to me and I'll teach you about God. See, some people say, well, I know God. They don't know God. They ain't never met God. All they know is a spook or a spirit. The messenger say, you teach the people of me and I'll teach the people of God. He's the one that met God. He sit down with God for over 3.5 years. I never met God, and the average person out there never met God either. And the average person believes that God is a spook or a spirit somewhere up in the sky, beyond the sun, moon, and stars. That's what the average person believes. I don't care whether they're Muslim or whatever they are. That's what they believe. They don't believe God is a man. And they don't believe that man is the most intelligent being on the place, on the face of the planet Earth. You don't know nothing on the planet that's more intelligent than man. Not a lion, not a tiger, not a bear, not a whale, not a shark, not a bird up in the sky. Man is the most intelligent being. And if you try to make God anything but a man, you make him less than a man. You don't know nothing more intelligent than man.
Praise be to Allah. Let's look at this.
Now, let me say one thing now. Okay. The white man is a god, but he's an evil god. He's not with the supreme being, but he is a god.
That is true. That is true.
Right.
The Nation of Islam, under the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, was a well-established organization before Malcolm went to prison. Actually, Malcolm was introduced to the Nation of Islam by his brother, who was actually in the Nation of Islam.
Right.
So, his brother joined the Nation of Islam and was a follower of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. And then he introduced that to Malcolm when he was in prison. I'm sure he was probably trying to deter him from his life of crime and cheating and pimping and all kind of different things that he was doing, home invasion and different things like that. And it was the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that played a big role in him being released from prison, and also teaching him, writing him,
right,
giving him the time of day that he did not have to. But it wasn't because Malcolm was some bright shining star. It was some prophecy that he was going to rise to be something. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad duty was his people. So it was no big eyes and little U's to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. His job was to be the messenger to the so-called American Negro in North America, right? That's what he was sent to. So his job was to deliver the message to each and every one of us at the best way he could. And there was nobody, the message was not too big for any of us.
To teach us to
reform us or to bring us back into the knowledge of ourselves and back into our true identities, put us back into our true names, and bring us back, and most importantly, to our true God. So Malcolm was one of many who received letters from the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad,
yes,
and received love and attention from the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And Malcolm was one of many that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad helped get out of prison and clean him up and make him something. Mm-hmm. Malcolm was a rise to the position where he could be an employee of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And when you were an employee of you brothers can clarify this, when you are a minister or you work in the nation or if over a temple or a mosque, how are you paid? Like, where does your money come from? Is it come from your job you work on the side? Is it come from? How are you survive?
You would get a salary from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You know, even though that was your temple, you was in that city. You know, but we, just like you do with your, like we do with this country here. Before I got my check, I see all these little deductions, mm-hmm, you know. Something got to go to the number poor, mm-hmm, treasury, mm-hmm, which is the thing that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad propagates the faith with, mm-hmm, you know. And these people are helpers of his. These are people, that's what they do. They supposed to be doing that all day, every day.
And Brother Shahid, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad had plenty of real estate holdings. This is something we don't see other so-called black leaders having then or even today. But he had apartment buildings and he also had single family homes.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And these homes were available to members of the Nation of Islam and also non-members of the Nation of Islam.
Gee.
And Malcolm was afforded the opportunity to be a renter in one of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's homes.
Right.
So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught him knowledge of himself, raised him up, cleaned him up, made him somebody, gave him position, gave him a salary. So he paid him. He took care of his wife and children financially. He made sure that Malcolm was eating, that the family ate. If Malcolm was out of town working, they made sure that the family was okay, the children were taken care of and protected. He gave him a home to live in. So the most honorable Elijah Muhammad is doing all this for Malcolm. What independence or things that he have on his own outside of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad providing everything for him? Because to my understanding that if the Malcolm's children were hungry or his wife needed something, that, you know, the messenger would send someone over or send something to the house, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what independence did Malcolm have from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad?
Well, the word independence is not a part of that scenario at all. You know, that was a job, full-time job, being a minister. You know, like you say, the home is provided for. The salary is provided for.
So
now, so, I don't know if anybody would have time to, probably some loyalists from the temple might go over and do certain things for the family that needs to be done, because we took care of our own. We didn't have any business, especially by that example of being a minister, of seeking anything of our own. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad's mission was to, like you said, the black man, all of us, whether we were Christians or what, this man was in prison.
So
we got him from.
So Malcolm, he didn't work at Ford. He didn't have a big business on the side. He had all his money coming in or nothing like that.
All this money. When he died, he had an estate of $39.75.
Well, how can that be true if he's some big time black leader?
Let me say something, brother.
Well, this is this published.
Okay.
Let me say something.
This for public consumption.
All ministers in the mosque were not being paid. It's according to how big your mosque was.
Okay.
Now, if your mosque was big enough to support you and you didn't have a job or you quit your job to be there full time, then you got a salary. But if you did, but if your mosque was a small mosque, most of the ministers then, they had a job. They worked or they owned some type of a business themselves. That was it now. So everybody wasn't getting paid. So that's what people have a misunderstanding. You think everybody was getting paid. I was a lieutenant at first. I wasn't getting paid at first, but then I got hired by the bakery. So I started getting paid. I quit a job that I had working for this, what is this?
Let me ask this, Brother Shahid.
What?
Was Temple Number 7 big enough to take a salary?
Yeah, New York was. New York was bigger than Chicago because they had other Temple Number 7A, 7B, 7C. Had more.
So the temple was big enough for him to take a salary, so he took a salary.
Right.
And even if and especially as a national representative, you definitely full-time for the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Right.
So everything that goes in your belly comes from the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Right.
So he had nothing of his own outside of the Most Honorable Elijah, what he gave him. Because he worked day and night or full time.
That house lived in, that wasn't his house.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on, Shahid.
Wasn't Malcolm's house. That's why he got put out.
So you saying that...
It wasn't his house. That was...
So you saying that Malcolm X was getting evicted?
Yeah.
He was a renter getting evicted?
That's not your house.
They was giving him that house based on him being the minister.
Right. You the minister.
You work. You need a stable place, like you said. You need this. You need that. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad supplied you with the wherewithal to continue doing that. But we do it based on belief, charity.
But brothers, what we being told is that that was Malcolm's house. Malcolm bought that house.
That's a lie. It was not his house.
So Malcolm didn't buy the
house. That was the nation's house.
It was in the nation's name.
Right.
Yeah. Nice house. I've seen that house. Malcolm, but I saw the house.
Right.
So the house belongs to the nation.
Yeah.
He was a renter or he was allowed to stay in the house.
Right.
Right.
And he was also being evicted from the house.
Right.
Right.
Because he was defected or he was put out of the Nation of Islam.
Right.
Okay, so he was being put out of the house.
He left the nation, so that's it.
Okay, so is it regular practice, and that was in New York City?
Yeah, that was in New York.
Okay, so is it regular practice when you're evicting a tenant that you go through court or do you burn the house down to get them out?
No, not.
Well, it was in court, you know, but somebody burned the house down. I don't know. Somebody burned the house down last night, I heard, but it's usually malice. Somebody is doing it for some kind of profit or to avoid paying something.
Because any real estate investor, let's just think logically. I'm a real estate investor. I buy a home. I put a renter in the home. Okay, the renter lose their job. They no longer can pay the rent. Okay, I got to put them out. The messenger had him in court to put him out the house because he was renting. He was a rental. It was a rental home.
Right.
Yeah.
So he didn't own the home. He didn't own nothing.
Right.
So the messenger putting him out the house. He had him in court. Would it make sense? I mean, it seems like if a messenger did a lot of stuff cash. The messenger didn't use credit. He bought property cash.
Mm-hmm.
So I bought this property cash. I got a renter in there. Okay, I'm putting the renter out. We in court, going through eviction court, trying to get this renter out of there. And would it make sense for me to still be profitable if I burn the house down? Because once I burn it down, I can't re-rent it to nobody else. And all that money I spent buying it, it's going to waste.
If you went down 87th Street, right after what's that street? Where the big school is?
Mm-hmm.
On 87th Street, you're going east.
Okay.
That'd be Ashland.
What you mean?
Okay. We had three apartment buildings there.
Right. Okay.
I lived on the first floor at 24th, what was the address? No, I forgot what the address was, but I lived in there. I paid rent every month. Mm. Everybody that lived in there paid rent every month. Muslims lived there, and plus Lost Founds lived right. there. Mm-hmm. Other words, black people lived there. Sir. And we had three buildings there that the nation had bought. And the messenger wanted to put all Muslims in there, but all Muslims just went in there. But I lived in there. I lived on the first floor. Nah, that's where I lived. But I paid rent every month.
And Shahid right. told me that the brother used to come around to collect it. He said that the messenger told him just get the money
on. Oh, no. That was in another building okay. where his sister lived. She wasn't a Muslim sister, and so she tried to, you know, seduce him. And he told her, he said, sister, the messenger told me don't get nothing but the money. And that's okay. what he did.
So, okay, so this makes more sense then, because as in my own professional career as a property manager, and I been able to manage high rises downtown, north side, the south side of Chicago. Mm-hmm. And I understand the eviction process and how that all that stuff goes. And I also understand that when you're putting a renter out, when they can't no longer afford for whatever reason you're evicting them, oftentimes they trash the house. They trash that unit, that apartment unit.
Right.
To be vindictive because they're angry that they're being put out.
Right.
So it wouldn't make sense for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad or any minister or anybody else to go burn down a house that he bought cash and right. got a renter in there and that he can't re-rent it nowhere.
Right.
But we have history from even to today. Like it's common practice for a disgruntled renter being put out
sure.
to just tear up. I mean, they even tear out walls. They do all kinds of different mm-hmm. things. Tear up the doors, bust the windows. Why would the messenger want to tear down, burn his own house down?
Let me say something, brother. See, Muslims
but he
had
was accused of it.
A reputation now.
Mm-hmm.
And a reputation was that if you did something improper to the Muslims, to the Nation of Islam, you will get a good whooping.
Okay.
Now, and people knew that.
But
the FOI would get you. So,
right.
And if you know that the FOI going to get you, if you come and destroy some of our property, you're going to get a good A-whooping, a good one, too.
All the more reason why it's safer to just burn it down anonymously.
So
I'm not accusing him of that. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying how they had blamed us for it. But mm-hmm. we were doing what we always do, the upright, the righteous, the civil thing to do. It was in court.
Okay. And we were in court. The Nation of Islam was in court against
evicting.
Right. Okay. So I guess it's safe to say that the depiction of Malcolm X the movie with those brothers in those suits and ties running over there firebombing the house that wasn't.
Yeah, that's a movie.
That's not true.
That's a movie.
That's something in the mind of Spike Lee.
Okay.
Let me tell you something, brother. I go to the movie for entertainment. I don't go for no truth. I go for entertainment. That's me.
But we are so-called Americans. We go mm-hmm. for facts. We right. don't go for entertainment.
Right.
We go for facts. Anything we see on that computer
that's
screen.
That's a movie.
Or that
a
movie
document is different facts. From a movie.
But that's how we see it. We see it as facts.
Right.
If Spike Lee put it out there, it's got to be
well,
facts.
That's what Negroes believe. That's a fact.
Well, okay. All right, so let's say that, okay. So the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was a man of great honor and integrity. And he always did things the proper and right way. And that's how he taught us to conduct ourselves. And that's how he led by example. Now, the Malcolm X, since you say that, you know what, let's take a break before we get into this next point. Brothers and sisters, thank you for tuning in thus far. We got some more very interesting conversation coming mm-hmm. after this. We got some good points we want to make after this break, so we're going to take this quick break and be right back.
My name is Carmela Muhammad, owner of a Foodie Spot restaurant located at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and the new Let's Eat to Live restaurant located at 621 East 67th Street. Both restaurants are located near the Obama Center, the Foodie Spot in the South Shore area, and Let's Eat to Live in the West Woodlawn area. It was very important to us to have nutritional food for our community. So what you can expect at both of our restaurants: healthy and clean food with a soulful twist, halal meat, non-genetic modified vegetables, and wild-caught fish. As we grow and expand, we're working towards delivering food straight from our farm to table. If we can improve the eating habits and the dining experience of our people in the community, we have done our job. So visit us at the Foodie Spot at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and Let's Eat to Live at 621 East 67th Street.
Welcome back. Again, we are having a very good, interesting conversation, and I am Ismail Muhammad, great member of CROE here, if I say so myself. And I'm joined by the co-founders of this organization, Brother Shahid Muslim and Brother Halif Muhammad, and we're having a discussion about the true history of Malcolm and the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the Nation of Islam. So we, as believers, or even in the Nation of Islam, defined Malcolm X as a hypocrite. And the reason why I see him as a hypocrite and will always see him as a hypocrite and never could really see him as my brother is because the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he set the foundation for that. He said that he's not a brother of ours, that he is a hypocrite, and that he is not someone that would... He's irredeemable, is the is the way I'll put it. And the reason why the messenger had that stance, not because he was angry or not because he was so-called jealous or anything like that, because the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is a Muslim. And as Muslims, we go by the laws that are written in black and white in the Holy Quran. Now, we say that he is a hypocrite because he once said he believed. He made a declaration, put it in writing, and said that he believed, and then he also spoke that publicly for years. And then after he was put out, he said publicly that the reason why it wasn't because of the slanderous things that he said about the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was the reason why he left. He said himself that the real reason was it was a personality difference. So, and he also stated that he once believed that when the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was teaching separation, that he was teaching about obtaining a separate state. But according to what I know of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad from his own words, he said that I will never ask for a separate state in your house before you even willing to give me one. So he was not asking the government or pleading for the government to give us a separate state or to move us some type of place. He continued to build a nation within a nation. And so the messenger said that it would be best if we had a separate state and that we move that way and we'd be away from you and you give us 20 to 25 years of support to help us build up our own society, our own way, our own nation. But that is not a demand or criteria or requisite of that, or some type of path to prosperity that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was dangling in front of us, that we're going to move to a separate state. The messenger said that we need to get out the way.
Yeah.
That this is the resurrection, that he is here delivering the message of the resurrection. God is here with him, and this is the time. And that he is teaching us the message, and his only job is to deliver the message plain and clear. Mm-hmm. I never heard the messenger advocating or promoting that bringing people into the Nation of Islam, or getting our hopes up that we're going to be moving to some separate state. But Malcolm said that on national television, that as long as he thought that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad believed that we were going to get, that he was moving us to a separate state, he was with him. So he wasn't with him because he was a Muslim, or because he believed in the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad as the messenger, or believed God appearing to us as a man. He said that he was with him because he thought that we were going to get a separate state. And that he said it wasn't because of the things that all the disrespectful things, the slanderous things that he said about him. He said that wasn't the reason. The reason was personalities.
Right.
That's what Malcolm said.
Yeah.
So
that's exactly.
He lied in that press conference, and he lied to the public, and he lied right. everywhere. And then he come back and he's just telling the truth on himself. That's how we know he lied.
Yeah.
So he's a liar.
Mm-hmm.
And we know how Allah feels about liars in the Holy Quran.
Teach.
So when it comes down to it, we go by the Holy Quran. Mm-hmm. And we see the Honorable Elijah Muhammad as he stated his title was the Messenger of God. Mm-hmm. He is not a prophet. Mm-hmm. He never said he was a prophet. He never came to prophesy. Nothing. He said, I have nothing to prophesy. He is not a prophet. We are clear that Prophet Muhammad of 1400 years ago is the last prophet, the seal of the prophets. Mm-hmm. We know that. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is a messenger for us. And that's how he presented himself, and that's how we perceived him, and that's how we conduct ourselves accordingly. So with that being said, brothers, the Holy Quran says, woe to the slander and defamer of the messenger.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Quran depicts what a hypocrite is, one who believes, disbelieves, and believes and disbelieves again.
Right.
And in his heart is a hardening of his heart, and he will never be returned back.
Right.
But with that being said, brother, Malcolm said that he was with the messenger, and he was a Muslim because he thought that he was a lie. We're going to get this separate state. And then he said that he went over to the east. Now, we already said that if the messenger cut him off for money, he didn't have any money.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have anything else but from the messenger. So we know that his sister, who was, I believe, was an attorney, she financed his pilgrimage to Mecca in the east.
Right.
Now, here goes some more hypocritical stuff. He went under the cloak of a pilgrimage, but he actually went for the purpose of gaining some type of monetary support, some type of social support, or some type of support from the Muslims in the east,
mm-hmm.
because he had already been to the east with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad years prior to.
Right.
And the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad also made a tour through the East and North Africa years before Malcolm's second trip back to the East.
Right.
Right.
So we know that. So now this man, he has like no integrity in his body.
Right.
This man is just, I don't know, he's just disgraceful.
Yeah. Now you prove it by, you know, listing those things. First, you know, you said that he was with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad until he found that it didn't appear like we were going to separate into a separate state. Yet, now, of course, he didn't have a long life. He needed 15 days in order to live 1 year. outside of the nation. But during that time, I didn't hear him going around trying to convert anybody to Islam, you know, since he was a true Muslim now, you know. Not to mention the fact that going over to the East and hoping that he can promote some kind of brotherhood because he had lost it here, it's the same thing I said about Alex Haley in his book. Somebody famous dies, and I say, well, I've been interviewing him, and this is his autobiography. It's about making money. And that's no joke about what his estate held. That's what we do. We go search. We don't just stay here and people phone us and give us information. We went on tours around this country and sometimes out of it, seeking information to verify the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And you can't go nowhere and you don't find some kind of impression that he's made with other nations. That's why the people turned him away, turned their backs on him in the Arab world. They knew this definition about hypocrisy of somebody like Malcolm. In the Quran, it says we don't even stand by the grave, you know, that even after their life is over, you know.
We don't ask forgiveness or stand by the grave.
Right.
And I think you made a very good point. Since he was a true al-Islam Muslim, he didn't start a mosque. He didn't become an imam.
Right.
He didn't convert people to Islam. He didn't bring nobody to Islam. Right. I think he started an African-American advancement.
Right.
I don't think he started that. I think he joined it.
Yeah, he joined.
He joined it. So he didn't really start anything on his own, nor did he have anything on his own. And everything that he taught, everything that people love him for was the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teachings. Yeah. So he didn't make it a complete year outside of being put out of the Nation of Islam before he was murdered.
Right.
And so in this 11 months, he was supposed to have been, you know, but he spent he spent 6 months in the East.
Teach.
Right.
So he spent 6 months in the East. He was only alive for 11 months outside the Nation of Islam.
Right.
That leaves him what 4 months?
4 months.
It leaves him 4 months in the States.
Impression.
Right. To be
that
this.
You hear about now.
And his sister paid his way.
And his sister paid
and
for.
And we didn't have social media at that
right,
time.
Right. Right. So everything had to be through newspaper. Or if he can get on TV, or he would have to do some type of touring around to try to get some rouse some things up.
That's why the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Bible says, when he speak a lie, he speak his own. Now, we have been living off these lies for decades now. And at the same time, the one who shows a empire, not just physical, but I'm talking about in the hearts and minds of people whose lives that you and I know that are on the earth still today that's been affected by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You don't find that with the people who so-called left with Malcolm, you know.
Right.
Adam Clayton Powell said once they're going to go into oblivion if, you know, without Malcolm X, he was the most fiery speaker. They'll just go back into. And then Farrakhan comes on the scene with the same kind of humility of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you know, who replaced him. So the Nation of Islam continued to thrive. It was already going straight up, you know, like a helicopter. It's right. In a rocket, you know.
Right. And so we no longer have to defend ourselves or try to convince people that the Nation of Islam, and particularly the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, had absolutely nothing to do with his murder because the FBI have already come out publicly and said, we did it.
And if they say...
So, and there's no statute of limitation on murder, but obviously it is when it comes to the FBI.
Yeah.
But when Malcolm went to the East and he trying to get money and support, they told him, I think you better go back and go be with the messenger.
Right.
Go be with Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yeah.
Go be with your leader. Because
yeah.
We ain't got nothing over here for you.
Right.
So when he came back to the States, he didn't have nothing there. He had no money when he went. He had no money when he came back. They sent him back broke, and that's why he had to go join these organizations, trying to get popularity, trying to get some type of be seen or something like that, have some type of relevance. Because the man was done.
Yeah, he ran into Muhammad Ali, didn't even want to speak to him outside the country.
Right.
Now somebody that they give him credit for bringing in the nation.
Right. You know? And I want to say this last thing, Brother Shahid. I know you got some things that you want to say, but the Holy Quran says that a hypocrite is in the lowest depths of the fire. Mm. He's below the devil.
Yeah.
The hypocrite is in the lowest depths below the enemy of God.
Yeah.
He's in the very bottom depths of the fire. Brother Shahid, what you want to say?
First of all, when Muhammad Ali found out he had been put out of the mosque, he cut him loose immediately.
Right.
Because he knew what would happen. But see, brothers and sisters, we got to really look at the Muslims, because if the Honorable Elijah Muhammad would have had something to do with the killing of Malcolm X, he would have been put in jail. But the white man knew, because the white man had his house
wiretapped.
Yeah, wiretapped. So he knew everything, what was going on.
All of his
he
homes.
Knew the messenger
and the mosque
had nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
They know that, mm-hmm. but they ain't gonna tell you that.
Right.
See,
they also had informants.
If they tell you that,
yeah.
Then they say, well, we know he's in it. But long as they can put some type of things on the messenger to make you believe he has something to do with that, that's what they gonna keep putting out there to turn you away from Islam as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's all the white man wanna do. Keep you away from Islam that is taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Keep you away from the mosque. That's all they want to do.
So the Malcolm said that. So for 13 years, Malcolm believed in separation.
Yeah.
That's why he said he joined the nation, because he thought the message was going to get us a separate state.
Mm-hmm.
Now he said he believed in separation, and then when he was kicked out, then he said he believes in no type of segregation.
Right.
Right.
Or racism.
Gee.
So that's a hypocrite again.
Yeah.
So he a hypocrite on all, like you can't trust nothing to come out this man's mouth.
Right.
Like he ain't worth nothing but a bag of dog doo-doo.
Mm.
Like what can we take from this? But then he called the white man the devil for all these years.
Right.
And then they go put him on the United States stamp. Mm. What sense does that make? Why would the white people, the good Samaritans of this country want to use Malcolm X as a tool to destroy the Nation of Islam, which they did not do. It was no effect to it. But they wanted to deter us from seeing the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. Why was that?
Because they'd rather for you to follow Malcolm than the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Follow him where, though?
Well, nowhere. That's where you follow Malcolm. That's why they write books about Malcolm. They do things about Malcolm. They do everything they can to put Malcolm out there. And the average Negro that don't know nothing about Malcolm, because the average Negro that wasn't even born in 1965, they wasn't even on the planet. And these are the young people now who are loving Malcolm. But they don't know nothing about Malcolm. They don't know nothing about him. All they know is about what they done read. What's that book he put out? Ballot of the Bullets, or whatever it was. Yeah. That's all they done read.
So for these 4 months that he had
in the States,
after returning back from his pilgrimage, where he was unsuccessful in that.
Umrah. They call it Umrah. If you go to Mecca out of season, it's Umrah. You didn't go to Hodge.
Oh, so he went. Well, Spike Lee said he went to Hodge.
Well,
yeah, where Spike Lee? Yeah.
Spook Lee.
Yeah.
Is what Spook college
Lee.
Used
so,
to call.
So Spike Lee got that wrong too.
He got that wrong too.
Oh man. So ain't nothing in the movie true. Okay. All right.
He wasn't with Malcolm then.
So the only thing Spike Lee got right was his name.
Now look, we was looking at just a few minutes ago. Malcolm on the air, talking to the white man, referring to the great leader that they push up for us now, Martin Luther King, as the Uncle Martin. He said Uncle Tom, he was calling him for the white people.
Right, they asked him, do you still refer to him as Uncle Tom? And he says that he can't say that on TV because he can be sued for defamation of character.
Right.
So he calls him Uncle Martin, which is, I guess, a better respectful
title. Right.
Yeah, it is. But it doesn't fool anybody right. about the reference that he was making.
So just I guess he still saw him as Uncle Tom.
Yeah.
Okay.
The whole gambit, all of these people, he was talking about all these people who promoted him today, the ones who are in bed with Martin Luther King's ideology.
We got about 1 minute left. Is there anything we can find in these 4 months that Malcolm accomplished or achieved or has some type of great notoriety for, something we can say, man, he did one thing? Is there one thing we can find?
I told you what that one thing was. It was that 12 and a half years that he spent representing the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's what he did well. And that's what he should be remembered for. But the turncoat, the blasphemy, the slandering of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the man who gave him everything, should anger any group, because it shows the threat in your own group. Some of them may turn out like Malcolm. Mm-hmm.
Brother Shahid, can you think of one thing that the Malcolm X accomplished in those 4 months of his great tenure as this great black leader?
Anything that he did accomplish, he did it under the leadership of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
So we can't find nothing.
Once he got put out,
I can't find it. And I 4 months is not enough time, brother. I'm working with his life, and I can only come up with 13 years.
Okay.
And his sister paid his way for him to go over to the East. He didn't have no money.
Okay, so he didn't own anything. He didn't have any money.
No.
He wasn't successful pretending to be an Orthodox Muslim in the East. Okay, well, I think that's the end of the show here. I think we got a lot of information out. I appreciate you two brothers for sitting in. I thank the crew here at CROE TV. I thank the organization, CROE Archives. I am your host here, Ismail Muhammad, and we thank you for watching. Assalamu alaikum.